Good morning, church family. I hope you are all doing wonderfully well on this Palm Sunday. Now, this is a different kind of Sunday for us. We've never done Palm Sunday online before, as a church ever. And what makes this morning even more unique is that we're going to be taking communion together. Now, communion will be a lot different, so I encourage you to go ahead and push pause on the TV or however you're watching this and grab some chips and water or crackers and grape juice or wine or whatever it is that you need to take this with your family. And then we'll be taking that later on in the service together. This is going to be so different. Everything about this is going to feel different, but here we are, and we'll trust the Lord together. Now, as we come into our call to worship, I want to point you to one of my favorite passages in the entire Bible. And in fact, if you've been watching our online devotionals, you've very recently heard me speak about this. Psalm 8. Psalm 8 is singularly, to me, one of the most gorgeous passages in all the scriptures. And today, it highlights, we want to highlight what it talks about in terms of God's glory and majesty. Later on in the sermon, you're going to see me reference Psalm 8 because the children who watched Christ drive people out of the temple began to sing this psalm or began to sing praises to him. And what Jesus says is a fulfillment of this very psalm. Let's read Psalm 8 together. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Our God is majestic over the earth right now. And yes, our world is so broken and so filled with looming unknowns. But above all of this is a God who is reigning majestically and who's moving all of creation to its eternal end and good. You have a God who is on the move and who's on the scene and is at work right now to work his good pleasure. And I think that's absolutely incredible for us as we sit here in this somewhat feels like just a remarkable silence, watching as the God of the universe moves everything to his glory and purposes. Now this morning, friends, let's give ourselves to the Lord and let's trust his glorious grace. Let's look to the God who's majestic in the heavens and let's see him perform great and awesome things for us today. Your God is awesome. So let's sing, lift our voices together to his great and awesome name.
The Lord God. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story.
Palm Sunday. Kids, today we celebrate a special day in the life of Jesus. 2,000 years ago, Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem on a donkey, and people did something awesome. They lined the streets on either side of the road on the way into Jerusalem, and they laid down palm branches and their coats so that Jesus's donkey didn't have to walk on the ground. They were treating him like the king that he is. And they did something else that I want us to do today too. They said praises to Jesus. The people said, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, which is a way of praising God that he saves us. Now, I want you to write down praises. As a family, cut some strips of paper. I used colored paper, but if you don't have colored paper, that's okay. Maybe you have computer paper or some scraps of paper sitting around the house that you can cut. And then get together and write praises to God. On this page, I wrote, God is good. Do you remember at VBS, we celebrated that God is good? Even when life is scary, God is good. When things change, God is good. When life is sad, God is good. When life is unfair, God is good. And of course, when things are good, when life is good, God is good. Those are good lessons for me to remember right now. Once you've written down some praises as a family, go ahead and make them into a chain like this. I used a stapler, but you could use tape too. Loop them through one another. And I want to challenge you to make a chain that's 8 to 10 feet long so that each person in your family can hold a piece of the chain for the next part of our activity. I want you to take that chain in your hands, stand next to your family, and read one of the praises in front of you. This one says, Jesus understands me. And raise it up in the air, just like people did on Palm Sunday when they raised their branches and laid them down. Guys, God is so good. We have so much to praise Him for. I hope you enjoy this activity together as a family. I'm praying for you. You are so special, and you are so loved by God. Happy Palm Sunday.
Good morning, MBC Church family. Pastor Nathan has asked me to lead our church in the celebration of the Lord's table this morning. Obviously, we can't be together physically, but we certainly can be together in the spirit as we celebrate the Lord's table. We have a bit of a problem, however. We have no ushers and no elements, so we need some inventive measures this morning. I'm going to ask someone in your group there at home to go locate a couple substitute elements. I'm using a Ritz cracker and some pomegranate juice. You can get even bread and water if need be. But while someone is locating those elements, I would like to read for you a couple verses from Psalm 46. Particularly as we face this tremendous crisis in our day. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. So I begin this morning, I'd like to read Luke chapter 22, where the Lord instituted this celebration. Luke 22, verses 14 to 20. And when the hour came, he reclined at table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he broke the bread. When he had given thanks, he took it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Remember, the disciples were there at the table celebrating the Passover, remembering the night in Israel's history when they were leaving Egypt and God miraculously protected them from the judgment that came upon Egypt if they were willing to put the blood on the doorposts of their house. They were celebrating this event, and it was to be, shall we say, the old event, a symbol of this new event, that the blood that would be shed would be the blood of Jesus Christ, that he would become the Passover lamb for anyone who would repent and put their faith in him. And so Jesus sits with his disciples, telling them about the fact that there's a traitor here at the table and the rest of you men will deny me and I'm leaving you and you don't understand what's going on, but I do. I'm going to go to the cross and die your death so that you might find forgiveness in me. And in the midst of this, Jesus takes bread and a cup of wine and he gives them a command. He says, do this in remembrance of me. This is not a suggestion. This is not you ought to. This is, I command you to do this in remembrance of me. And we have been remembering this event and this command of Jesus from the first century until this present day. We come to remember that Jesus was about to suffer. And he says, this is my body that will suffer on the cross, and this is my blood that will be shed for you so that you might find forgiveness of sin and enter into this new covenant. He says something else very interesting. He says, I will not eat the Lord's Supper, this remembrance of me, until I eat it again with you in the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. And yet, a few days after Jesus' resurrection, he does celebrate it with them. And so we realize that the kingdom of God came the moment that Jesus died, rose again, ascended back to the Father, and was crowned King of the kingdom. That we celebrate all that Jesus did for us, yes. But most of all, he says, remember me. Remember me. We need to remember Jesus, his great love for us, his great concern for us, his care for us, and his plans for us that are assured because they're based upon his promises, not ours. As we celebrate the Lord's table, so we're celebrating that the kingdom of God has come, and it's come in Jesus himself. We have become part of the kingdom of God the moment we believe in him. And we have gotten into this kingdom because of the new agreement that God made with his people through his Son. And so Jesus gives them a command, and this morning we are here to obey it. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so if you would, to take whatever you have to be the bread this morning, that you would take it and eat it in remembrance of Jesus, of what was accomplished 2,000 years ago, and of the person who loved you and gave himself for you. Take and eat with me. And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, said, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant, the new agreement in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." Partake with me as we remember him. I trust that you have faith and confidence that the Lord Jesus Christ will take care of you. The greatest care that he ever took of you was taking your sin away and giving you entrance into his kingdom. And he will guide all of us through this event that we're facing, friends, because we know the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's close together in prayer. Father, we come to you with great thanksgiving and praise for what your Son did for us. We wait upon you to provide our protection, all of our needs in the midst of this difficult time. Father, help us to trust you, to live in your strength, not our own. We pray that you'd help us to be the gospel and share the gospel with those people we meet in this world who are thinking about you in ways they've never thought about you before. And so, Father, be with our church family, and help us to support one another. And thank you for this remembrance of Jesus. And we pray this in his name. Amen. May the Lord bless you and take care of you. If there's anything we can do for you, please let us know. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Happy Palm Sunday. Today's reading is from Matthew 21, verses 1 through 22. "Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once.' This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.' The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut down branches from trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before them and the ones that followed him were shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.' And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowd said, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee.' And Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who sold and bought in the temple. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeon. And he said to them, 'It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you make it a den of robbers.' And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things he did, and the children crying out in the temple, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant, and they said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes, have you never read
out of the mouth of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise. And leaving them, he went out of the city to Bethany and lodged there. Now, in the morning, as he was returning to the city, he became hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the wayside, he went to it and found nothing on it but only leaves. And he said to it, "May no fruit ever come from you again." And the fig tree withered at once. When the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, "How did the fig tree wither at once?" And Jesus answered them, "Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, 'Be taken up and thrown into the sea,' it will happen. And whatever you ask for in prayer, you will receive if you have faith."
I'd like to invite everyone to turn with me to Matthew 21, verses 1 through 22, for a message entitled "From the Jerusalem Streets to Our Lockdown Homes." Now, I'm just going to come out from the very beginning and say that this has been a recording nightmare today. In the past couple weeks, it has taken me about 40 minutes to record these things, and then I move quickly to my laptop and get them off to you. We're at hour 3 now, and I have probably taken 40 different takes. So, I'm going to stop, we're going to pray together, and let's jump into this very important passage. And let's marvel at what God shows us in here. Father, everything we have is yours. Everything I have is yours. This time, this experience, today and tomorrow, everything we have. So I ask, oh gracious God, that you would show forth your glory and grace in this passage that many of us are familiar with, and many of us find are still pretty new. Lord, I thank you for the goodness of your word. How someone who studied it for years can be so taken aback by new, fresh details and called by your spirit to new things. Father, I also thank you that people who are brand new to it can find pearls just sitting on the surface, diamonds, wonderful truths to change our lives. And I pray, Father, that you would change our life through this passage. What we're saying today has been recorded for our good and your glory, and so I pray that you would make your name known through us now. Help us to glorify and honor your name together, as we seek to show forth your glory and grace. Thank you for the time that we have to share, and I pray that you would make your name known in us now, even as we're far apart on this beautiful Palm Sunday. In your name, amen. So, here we are at Matthew 21, plopped right into the middle of the story of Jesus' life. And one of the things you're going to notice about this passage is that this is a passage that is extremely provocative and in which Jesus does a lot of things that are symbolic in their nature. Now, you've heard probably Jesus tell the parables. If you've studied or read the life of Jesus, you are familiar with the fact that Jesus told parables as a means of weeding out people who were on the fence about him. Parables were and still are very common teaching tools. In the first century, they were common, and today they're common. For example, you, I'm sure, are familiar with the story of the boy who cried wolf. The boy who cried wolf, he was off somewhere, and he started going, "Oh, a wolf, a wolf, a wolf." And all the adults ran to his side, and he started laughing. "Ha, ha, ha, I fooled you." And he did this several times until one day, he actually had a wolf. He cried wolf, and no one came to his side because no one believed him. Now, the moral of the story is don't hang out with wolves. Also, don't lie. But parables are extremely common. The movie Pixar is another such parable. In that movie, while it's on the one hand a very cool love story between two robots, it's also a story about the impact that we have, that our actions have on the world around us, and it's a call for planetary responsibility. Parables are everywhere, And we use them all the time. Stories are oftentimes told with points to make a point known. Jesus was no different. What makes Jesus different is the way that he taught them and the reasons he taught them. He specifically used parables to weed out people in the crowd who were on the fence. He was constantly driving people toward a choice. And that choice was this: follow him or not. Believe or don't. In Mark chapter 4, we see the disciples come up to him equally as confused as everyone else about what in the world Jesus' parables meant, and they ask him to explain it. In Mark chapter 4, verses 10 through follow, and what follows, it says, "And when he was alone, those around him with the twelve asked him about the parables. And he said to them, 'To you it has been given the secret to the kingdom of God. For for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see, but not perceive, and may indeed hear, but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven.'" Now, if you've read the Old Testament prophets, then you'll recognize the language here. Jesus is using a common metaphor the Old Testament prophets constantly railed against. The Old Testament prophets are filled with so many things in which they call God's people away from their rebellion and sin and back to God. And one such place was an idol worship. And the Old Testament prophets pulled no bones about mocking the idols, because even though they have eyes, they do not see. And even though they have ears, they do not hear. And one of the things you see the Old Testament prophets do is they began to say that the people have become like what they worship. That the Israelites who worship idols are people with eyes, and yet they don't see. The Israelites who worship idols are people with ears, and yet they don't hear. Jesus is lifting this up from this corporate understanding that everyone would have having read the Old Testament prophets. And he's saying that his parables were specifically designed to weed out those who were seeking to worship God and those who weren't. Now, what we see here in Matthew 21 is what scholars called an embodied parable. Embodied parable basically means Jesus is reenacting. He's acting out a parable to get people to make a choice, to drive them to see or to not see, to hear or to not hear. But you cannot stay on the fence with Jesus on these things. He is going to reenact, dramatize. It's going to be provocative. It'll be sensory. It'll be symbolic. It'll be all of these things. But the purpose is to drive people to make a choice about him. In Matthew 21, the people who were walking around Jesus at the time were given the choice: change or don't. But you can't stay on the fence. Get better or get worse, but you can't stay on the fence. It's up to you. It's your choice. And so let's look at the first embodied parable in Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. "Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say to them, "The Lord needs them," and he will send them at once.' This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Say to your daughter Zion, behold, your king is coming, humble, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.' The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks and sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Those were palm trees. That's why we call it Palm Sunday. And the crowds that went before him and followed him were shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!' And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city stirred up, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowd said, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee.'" So I want to pitch an idea to you. I want you to imagine that out of nowhere, I put on a suit and I get into a really nice stretch limousine with bulletproof glass, and I surround myself with men in suits with black glasses and earpieces, and they're constantly holding their ear and holding a gun. And then we put cars up on this front and the cars in the back, and there's a ticker tape parade, and we drive from here in Manahawkin, New Jersey, down to Washington, D.C. Now, in this strange story, I drive straight up to the White House, and I open it up, and I walk straight in, straight to the Oval Office, and I sit down. Now, based upon that silly story, what would you think I was saying about myself if I did all that? Obviously, you would think that I thought I was the President of the United States. Now, I'd be wrong, because I'm not, but all of my actions showed you that. This is what Jesus is doing here. This is a kingly motorcade for all practical purposes. The reason we know that Jesus is making a claim to be the Messiah, the King, is for, there are two things that give our real serious clues. First is verse 21. This took place to fulfill, 21 verses 4 through 5. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." Jesus was purposely reenacting a prophecy from Zechariah chapter 9. He was purposely putting on himself an Old Testament prophecy that was specifically for the king, when the king of Israel, the Messiah, would come into town. He is embodying purposefully this Old Testament prophecy. Second thing we know about this is that in verses 9 through 11, Jesus allows kingly songs to be sung about him as he comes into town. Verse 9, "And the crowds that went before him and followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." Jesus is embodying this Old Testament prophecy, driving people to make a choice. And thus we have our embodied parable. By reenacting, or as the book of Matthew says, fulfilling the Zechariah prophecy, he's essentially forced people to ask, is Jesus the Messiah or not? Like all parables, he's forcing them to make a choice. Will they see and hear and will they believe? Or will they see and hear and not perceive and not understand? The choice is up to them. And the second embodied parable is found in verses 12 through 17, when Jesus rolls up on the temple and guts it. Let's read verses 12 through 17 together. "And Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who sold and bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he said to them, 'It is written, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you make it a den of robbers.' And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant. And they said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouth of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise?' And leaving them, he went out of the city to Bethany and lodged there." It is very important that we understand the context of what's happening here so that we can actually put our mind around it. In those days, the temple was the cultural epicenter of both the Jewish life and commerce. So basically, the temple was in the center and all the rest of the world felt around that. And people who lived in faraway lands who would hazard the journey would come and buy livestock at the temple so they could make their temple sacrifices. This is a way of ensuring that you didn't hazard the life of your animal as you were traveling across the lands. And so, if done correctly, this was meant to be a legitimate form of enabling people to worship the Lord. It wasn't supposed to be something that got in the way. But look at what Jesus says about this. He says in verse 13, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of robbers." The phrase "den of robbers" is an intentional phrase used in the New Testament specifically about brigands and revolutionaries who were seeking to overthrow Roman rule. The purpose of the temple, Jesus says, was not to become a place where people like Barabbas plotted and schemed to overthrow the Romans. It was not to be a place where evil was planned out. It was to be a place for prayer for everyone. And it's very important also to recognize what Jesus did to those who were in there. He threw everyone out. He didn't just throw out the money changers. He threw out the people who were buying as well. People who had traveled from potentially faraway lands just to offer sacrifice there. Though he threw out those who sold and those who bought, the worshipers and those who were selling. Think about what Jesus has done here. He's essentially shut the whole temple down. He stopped the sacrifices. He stopped the worship. He's driven people out. He has removed all of the temple's reason for existence. And he's saying that this is from God. This is a judgment. The temple stands there empty now. And this is what God wants. And in that state, with that empty temple, Jesus starts ministering to people. In verse 14, we find that the blind and the lame come to him, and he heals them. And then, as the temple was empty, except for those that Jesus was healing, the religious leaders come in and they hear the songs that they had taught the people throughout the years. But they're not being sung just before the temple. They're being sung to a person. They're being sung to Jesus. These are songs not being sung to God in the heavens as they had been taught their entire life. They were singing the songs of God to Jesus. And in verse 15, the chief priest, we read this, "But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children were crying out in the temple, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant." Well, of course they were. This was a song meant for God. "And they said to him," verse 16, "'Do you hear what they are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise?' And leaving them, he went out of the city to Bethany and lodged there." Verse 16 is beautiful because it quotes Psalm 8. And in that psalm, it describes how God has given babies and nursing infants, the smallest members of society, a unique space and a unique power to silence God's enemies by their praise. This was a song only to be sung to God, and that's why the religious leaders were anxious. They are singing a song that's meant to be sung to God, to you. Do you not understand this? And Jesus says, yeah, and they're right to do it. In this whole thing, Jesus has essentially said, the worship in this temple is no longer acceptable to God. So I'm shutting it down. Now, worship is to me. He accepts the worship upon himself. What's the embodied parable here? What's the choice that he's making, drawing people to? By shutting the temple down and judging it, he's forcing people to say, is this the Messiah or not? The one who would bring about the new covenant and make us people who have hearts of stone and hearts of flesh. Like all parables, he's forcing them to make a choice about who he is. Will they see and hear and believe? Or will they see and hear and not believe and not perceive? It really is up to them. The final embodied parable comes in verses 18 through 22, where Jesus picks a fight with a fig tree. Now, if you're an arborist, I apologize ahead of time, but it's Jesus here, so you've got to argue with him. Verse 18 through 22. "In the morning, as he was returning to the city, he became hungry, and seeing a fig tree by the wayside, he went to it and found nothing on it but only fig leaves. And he said to it, 'May no fruit ever come from you again.' And the fig tree withered at once. When the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, 'How did the fig tree wither at once?' Jesus answered, 'Truly I say to you, if you have faith, but do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to this fig tree, but you will be able to say to this mountain, "Be taken up and thrown into the sea," and it will happen. And whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive if you have faith." Jesus just picked a fight with a fig tree. Now, this passage is oftentimes taught as a prayer passage. have lots of faith and you can take mountains and throw them around like cards. It's not exactly what's happening here. Jesus is making a grand point, and I want you to really see it. Follow with me. Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what's been done to the fig tree. Now imagine here that Jesus is standing right in front of this fig tree and says, to the fig tree. But even if you say to this mountain, and then he points to this mountain. He points to the temple mountain, where the temple is. The temple that he just gutted and judged. But even if you say to this temple mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, it will happen. Can you imagine the disciples' response? This is not a call to profound prayer. It is Jesus saying that there's a faith that God loves that's more important than the temple. But it's not about prayer in specific. It's a condemnation of the temple. Jesus just said, if you have the faith that God loves, you could take this thing, which is the epicenter of all of your religious life, and you could say, go. And it's just like throwing a rock into the water. Jesus told his disciples that there is a faith that God loves that is more powerful than the mountain and the temple on it. A faith so great that it makes the mountain and its temple little more than stones to be skipped on against the waters. And that faith is in him. Let me say this again. Jesus told the disciples that there is a faith that God loves and is more powerful than the mountain. A faith so great it makes the mountain and the temple on it little more than be stones to be skipped across the waters. And that faith is in him. What's the embodied parable here, friends? By judging and cursing the tree, Jesus is declaring that the temple is little more than a rock to be thrown. Essentially, he's forcing people to ask, is this the Messiah or not? And like all parables, he's forcing them to make a choice. Will they see and hear and believe? Will they see and hear and not perceive and understand? It truly is up to them. The temple at that point was like that fig tree. At all the appearance of glory and goodness and all of the vestments of something that was life-giving, but it had no life on it, you would come to it hungry and you would leave hungry. You would come to it unsatisfied. You would leave unsatisfied. You'd come to it with your sin and you would leave in your sin. And Jesus is saying, it is done. Just as I've withered the fig tree, I have withered the temple. Hello, church family. Now, obviously, I'm looking pretty different right now because I was just outside working and I realized that I needed to change the ending of the sermon. So I'm not dolled up or anything. We're being very raw right now. Go church. Go honesty. So what I wanted to do right now is I realized that the way that I had finished the sermon yesterday when I recorded the video earlier just didn't drive the point home to where people are. I entitled this message From the Streets of Jerusalem to Our Lockdown Homes because I wanted us to see how the work of Jesus in coming down on the donkey and then judging the temple and all that has a profound impact for people who are sitting in their homes right now. And what is that impact? Well, the basic fact is this. Jesus wasn't coming to condemn the temple. He came to replace it. Now, the book of Hebrews has this, and so I have my laptop in front of me. This is all happening right now. This is what Hebrews 8 says. Now, the point what we're saying is this. We have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven, a minister in the holy places, of the true tent which the Lord set up, not man. God in the entire book of Hebrews is built around this one major idea to show how the work of Jesus has superseded what came before. What came before was good and meaningful to the degree that it was used for its purposes to drive people into the presence of God. But as what has happened, it was a temporary promise. It was a promise that was to drive us home to the time in which God would come onto the ground and replace it all. And here's what I want us to see today is that because of the work of Christ to close down the previous worship, we now have something better and new. And basically it's this: Jesus Christ has become our means of engaging God. All worship no longer centers around a place. It centers around a person. Now, the Old Testament place was given to people to draw them to the person, but just like normally happens, places sometimes become things in and of themselves. But it was meant to drive people to God. And now the whole arc of Scripture has pointed to the fact that God's first temple has been replaced by the true temple, that is Jesus himself. And everything Jesus has done has changed the way that we come to God. Now you don't have to run to God via some other means. You don't have to go to a place. Why is it that we tell people you can pray right here, right now, and meet God? Because it's true. That's why we say that. Because it's absolutely true. You can come to Jesus just as you are, right where you are. Whether or not we ever go back to that building, and I hope we do, over on 400 Beach Avenue, I hope we do, but whether or not we ever do, that matters so secondarily to the fact that God has replaced that with worship of Jesus. We see in Matthew 12 that this was the plan of Jesus all along. In Matthew 12:6, Jesus, talking about the Sabbath, tells them, "I tell you, something greater than the temple is here," speaking of himself. And in John 12, which is a corollary passage to John 2, which is a corollary passage to our passage today, we read, "The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple with sheep and oxen, and poured out the coins of the money changers, and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, 'Take these things away, and do not make my father's house a house of trade.' His disciples remembered that it was written, 'Zeal for your house will consume me.' So the Jews said to him, 'What sign do you show us for doing these things?' Jesus answered them, 'Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up.' The Jews then said, 'It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?' Verse 21, but he was speaking about the temple of his body. And this is why in Matthew 27, and when Jesus died on the cross for our sins, it says that the temple veil was torn in two from top to bottom, because the veil that separated us between God and man is done. The whole Old Testament temple has been replaced with something better, and that is the temple, Jesus Christ. Now, let's understand just how good this good news is. The final sacrifice that the temple pointed to, all the sacrifices that the temple pointed to, pointed to one major sacrifice, the sacrifice of Jesus. And in his sacrifice on the cross, he has finally, fully remediated all the distance between God and man. All forgiveness and love and grace can be poured out to people because of what God, Jesus, has done on the cross. And now, even better, in his resurrection, Jesus has established a new covenant by his blood and by his resurrection, which he sits enthroned in heaven. And now anyone, anywhere, in any place can call on the name of the Lord and be saved. Anyone, any place can call on him and find grace and mercy to help in time of need. This is good news for people who are isolated. This is good news. Jesus triumphed coming down on the donkey, and Jesus triumphed coming into the temple and judging it, and Jesus triumphed and saying, "Take the temple and throw it into the sea," points all back to him and the grace that he's given us in Christ Jesus. Friends, I want you to see it, and I want you to hear it, and I want you to feel it, that where you are right now is a sacred space, because right here, right now, where you are, you can call out to Jesus and enter into the temple presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You don't have to go to a building to meet a person anymore. You can just go straight to him. What a gift. What a gift. What an amazing gift. So, on the basis of this, happy Palm Sunday to you, dear friend. Happy Palm Sunday. May it be that your heart finds its hope and joy in being able to go to Jesus with your needs right here and right now. He loves you. He took away the need to go to a place. Now you can just call out to Him. What an incredible God you have. What an incredible God you have who loves you so very much. And as we finish this Palm Sunday, I hope your heart is filled with joy that you right now could call upon Him with all of your needs, sin and fears and anxieties, and you can know that your God welcomes you. I am the lame person that Jesus heals. I am the broken and oppressed, and I am the child singing the song, all because Jesus has made a way for me to enter into the presence of God. And you can enter that presence too. So let's pray together as we finish. Lord, I thank you for this good news, which is so exciting. This good news that says that because you've shut down the old, you've made the new, and we can just enter into the presence of God with joy and delight. I thank you for how this news impacts me and all my friends. And I pray that this news would make sense to us now, that you would embed it deep within our souls. Because this is good news that we will need today, as good as in a time where bad news is everywhere. Father, these are unprecedented times for us. It's not unprecedented for you because you've endured tragedy alongside your saints before, but it is unclear to us how tomorrow will look or today. And so we thank you that in the midst of this bad news season that we can come to you and know that you accept us and that you hear us and you love us. Thank you so much for the joy that it is to be your children. In your name, amen.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm yours. My design, no one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place, to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way, back to you. To you.
Hello, church family. As we prepare for the announcements and the benediction, I want to first start off by telling you one of the things that we're seeking to do to be a meaningful part of serving our community. The first thing is this. We're looking to gather all masks and gloves so that we might be helpers to our first responders. You see people sewing masks these days, but first responders need what's called N95 or above masks. Basically, it's a mask that's made to prevent biohazardous materials in a much better way. If you are among the people who stockpiled these particular masks, or if you have some on hand, please let me know by calling the church office or emailing me at nathan@manahawkinbaptistchurch.org. We would love to find all these masks and pile them up and give them to the people who need them, the people who are on the front lines of the needs of our community. If you have them, please shoot us a call and let's donate them to the first responders as best as we can. Those people are risking their lives and are facing profound anxieties in their family so that you and I might be safe. So by whatever means possible, let's not only pray for them, but let's be part of their solutions of having actual tools on hand to make sure that they are safe. That would be awesome. So N95 mask and nitrile gloves. Also, youth groupers. Youth group is now online, and if you are between the ages of 6th grade and 12th grade, you can be a part of our youth group online stuff using Zoom and Facebook Instagram Live. If you want to know more about that, please go to facebook.com/manahawkinbaptistchurch.org. It's our Manahawkin Baptist Church Facebook page. Look it up, and in there you'll find a post that tells you how to connect with our youth group using Zoom and Instagram Live on the various nights that they're doing this. Also, we really want to know how you're doing. And the link in the comment section where you're watching this, there's a link for a connection card. And this one goes a little deeper than our previous connection cards. Basically, we really want to know how the... I'm sorry, this is take 10. We're doing all right. We really want to know how the coronavirus is impacting you and your family. And we also want to see if you have job loss or financial hardship, or if people that you know are facing financial hardship or potential coronavirus infection. We want to be walking alongside you as the body of Christ. So please keep us updated. Take the time to fill out that form using the link above to tell us how you're doing. It really matters to us that we as a church family know how to support one another in this time. So don't just say, here's my prayer request. Tell us what's happening in your world. We're trying to catalog this data and we're trying to be as effective ministers of the gospel to our community as possible. And finally this. Giving. The final thing is this. Please continue to give to our church. We have an online giving mechanism, but there are other ways to do it as well. Our church, like any other nonprofit, is being hit by this economic downturn, and we want to continue to be able to do the work of the church together. So if you have the ability, please find a way that's best for you to give to our church. There's no pressure to do this. We do want to keep our church running, and we do have serious operational expenses that are happening right now. But let the Lord lead you on that, and we encourage you to do that using any one of the mechanisms below, above, such as online giving or whatever else. All said, we're just honored to walk alongside you into this looming unknown that we're all experiencing together. Now, the benediction. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. You have a God who's reigning in the heavens. He's majestic and glorious, and he has given you the ability to make his name and renown known with your voice. Your voice isn't small. It is the very trumpet of God. And so, dear friend, dear brother and sister in Christ, use your voice to make Christ known this day. Your God has given you all access to himself. He is the new temple, and you can call upon his name wherever you are, even where you are right now, and know that he hears you. And wherever you are, you can call out to him for others, and he will hear you. The temple is found in Jesus now. And so be part of the song of the children, and make his name and renown known. We love you very much. Have an absolutely beautiful week, and we'll see you soon.